morning. Welcome, everyone, and welcome to Bear Creek Nature Center. My name is Mary Jo Lewis, and I'm the supervisor here at Bear Creek. And I see some familiar faces, some of our volunteers, some new faces, so that is wonderful. Bear Creek Nature Center is part of El Paso County Parks and Community Services Department, and we're also supported by the Friends of El Paso County Nature Centers. That's our nonprofit entity that supports us financially as well and contributes and supports to our environmental education endeavors. And the program that you're here for this morning is sustaining watersheds with rain barrels. And this is part of our sustainability series that we've been doing for the past couple of years. And the mission of El Paso County Parks and of our Friends group is to connect people to their natural and cultural resources and inspire them to be stewards for the parks and the environment. And the sustainability series is really a perfect tie-in to that mission. It's not just inspiring people to be stewards, but it's really giving them tools and resources and knowledge to do so. And one of the reasons that this series is so successful is because we have such knowledgeable folks in the community in El Paso County who are willing to come in here and lend their time and their talents to teach us about a variety of topics that help us live with a lighter footprint. And today we're so excited and so grateful. We have Allison Plute from Colorado Springs Utilities and the Greenway Fund, and Sean Holveck from the Greenway Fund Board, who are here to teach us more about our watersheds, the health of our watersheds, and rain barrels and the new laws. Before we leave today, if you haven't already, I encourage you to grab our spring program guide on your way out. It has all of our programs that go from now to the end of May, sustainability series, active adult series, children's programs, family programs. We try to offer ourselves and our sister nature, Fountain Creek Nature Center, try to offer a wide variety of programming that serves our community. So thanks again for being here, and pass it over to Allison and Sean. Thank you.
Thanks for coming out and spending your Saturday morning here. This is one of my favorite places in El Paso County. I used to be an employee here and really cherish the days that I got to educate people on a regular basis out of this nature center and on the trails. And so if you haven't had an opportunity, please enjoy this free nature center. It's a great asset, as is the one down at Fountain Creek Park. So wonderful opportunity to learn more about our natural environment. And we're really excited to be here as part of the sustainability series. Both Sean and I work on the city's sustainability efforts as well. So if you're interested in additional things that are happening in the community, we'd be happy to talk to you about that after the program. So we're going to kind of tag team this, and as you see, we've got a rain barrel that we'll be giving away. So just a kind of introduction, my name is Allison Plute. I work for Colorado Springs Utilities, but today I have my Greenway Fund board hat on. Has anyone heard of the Greenway Fund? Raise your hand. Couple of you out there? Okay, well, we are really excited to share a little bit about what the Greenway Fund is. And so let's go ahead and get started.
All right, cool. So I'll introduce myself as well. I'm going to kind of walk around because if you're not here to learn about what sustaining watersheds with rain barrels are, at least you'll get a free rain barrel or a chance to win a free rain barrel at the very end. So I'm going to give everybody a ticket. And then as I walk around, I introduce myself. So as Allison said, and actually, I'm going to give you some of these.
Just have to grab them.
And then that way we can split the room. And then give everybody a ticket on this side. As Allison said, so I'm a board member on the Greenway Fund. People think I work for the Greenway Fund all of the time. I don't. I just work with them. I don't get paid for them. I just am involved because I care about our community. And of course, I love our trails. And all of our trails are actually in our watershed. I love the watershed too because it's a geographical delineation. It's not political, it's not anything except for what I think it's our number one asset of the reason people live here in Colorado Springs. Because we all love, what's that big thing to the west of us? Anybody know? Anybody? All right, well, Pikes Peak. That's to the west of us, in case you weren't, because we haven't gotten involved yet. This is an interactive presentation as well. So be prepared to raise your hands, answer questions, laugh a little bit, you know, have a good time today, all right?
And to kick that laughter and good time off, I did find a rain barrel joke. I'm super excited to share this with you. So, what's the difference between a rain barrel and a bad outfielder? One catches drops and the other drops catches.
Oh. Sorry. Alright, well at least there was a little laugh.
I'm getting one.
That's good. It just went like... All right, so to tell you guys a little bit about the Greenway Fund, to start off with, I'm just going to kind of give you an overview. We were formed about 5 years ago on the basis, with our mission is to advance our regional waterways' unique assets, impacting the environmental, economic, and recreational vitality of our community. So what does that mean? So we've kind of boiled it down into three simple words that you can remember. Create, connect, and protect. So as you think about our waterway, you think about our region, we are creating ways, creating places in which you can connect with the water. So if you will go down to America the Beautiful Park, Creekside is one of the projects that we first started with. We've also worked with GOCO, which is a funding mechanism on the state level, to start the funding for phase one of the Legacy Loop. That's kind of one of our biggest projects that we're working with Parks and Rec and the city, and actually county parks as well, to finish the Legacy Loop, so actually connect the loop. And then there will be a couple of different stages to not only finish the loop, but to then build up and really invest in our own community. So that's our create part. And then the connect is we have splash events, which are, you know, we have events down by the river that we encourage people to interact with the water. Not necessarily get all the way in and swim. I mean, it's kind of shallow. It's kind of, you know, there's a lot of things that we can improve about our creek. So, but we provide opportunities or create opportunities to connect with our water, whether that be through the trails, through the parks, through events. That we do. And then of course protect is what we're doing here. We're talking about protecting the environment, protecting the water, having safe, healthy waterways, which is actually bringing me to the next part, which is our vision. Do you have a little clicker?
I do have a little clicker.
Okay. I'll get the hang of it here in a second. Okay, so our vision, which is pretty simple, is we're gonna do what we do with our mission, and then what we hope to see in the end is safe, healthy, and connected waterways. So that the people of our watershed and those downstream, that's important, downstream, can connect our water, or can connect to our water for an improved life. So basically we believe that just like every other community around Colorado, when we have the opportunity to interact and play with our water, one, it becomes important, two, it adds recreational opportunities and fun and vitality to your life. Okay, pretty simple. Everybody likes to play in the water, interact with the creeks, with nature. I think we're all standing here at a great nature center because of that, and we're interested to learn about how we make and protect that nature so that we and our children and the children's children can enjoy it. Right. Anybody have any questions yet about the Greenway Fund? All right, cool. We'll let Allison introduce you and tell us a little bit about your job and what you do with utilities as well as what you do for Greenway.
Sure. Thanks, Sean. Colorado Springs Utilities. We are your four-service water provider. We have over 650,000 customers that we provide those services to on a day-in, day-out basis. We have a $1 billion budget. And my role with Colorado Springs Utilities is Watershed Project Manager. So I work from Palmer Lake to Pueblo, including Woodland Park and our 14 there, Pikes Peak, teaching people about how to protect our watershed, working on projects that are going to prevent erosion, going into the schools. So I do a lot of work in the community, which I love, and working with our partners is how we can get a lot of things done. I've been on the Greenway Fund Board for about 2.5 years now, and Sean and I tag team and chair the events committee. So we're out there putting together these great events for our community. So I'm from Minnesota, I love water. You know, another Minnesota over there, he has a role in that dish. So it's just something that I've always been connected to, and I'm really fortunate to be able to have that as my career and as my board interest as well.
Thanks, Allison. All right, so as you can see, we're going to pass this back and forth. So as we talked the first thing I want to do is define a few terms. So what is a watershed? That's actually a question for you guys. Anybody want to answer that? What's a watershed? Nobody?
It's an area where all the water drains into one river.
Very good. That's pretty much it. It's an area, a geographical area. It's defined by a geographical area of which all of our water, or the water in that area, drains down from one end to another end. And all drains into a common body of water. Watersheds vary in size and shape, of course. They are defined by the geographical features in them. As we know, we live on or live close to the continental divide, and so therefore everyone's pretty familiar. We live pretty close to where most of the water runs west, and then most of the water runs east, right? So just to define a watershed, you can kind of, this is a nice little graphic. It rains, it falls on the top part, it's like a big funnel, it goes all the way down to the ocean. That's a really big watershed. And then all of that big watershed is made up of smaller watersheds, which we live in, a little bit of a smaller watershed, and a very unique watershed. So this is a little bit of a difficult graphic to kind of understand, just because I think normally what we're looking at is this little black line. This is our mountain ranges, right? So all of these watersheds, they go to the east. And then all of the, west, thank you. All of these go to the west, all of these go to the east. So there's only, what, 1, 2, 3 that are going west right now.
East.
For correcting me. All right, so all the water is going west. We all live on what side?
East.
There you go. So that creates kind of a unique issue, right? In that all of our water is going away from where all of the people who are using it for agriculture, water, or drinking water, watering our plants, all of those other things that we're using water for. So, as you can see, it kind of creates a little bit of an interesting problem, which is really important as to how we manage our water. Oh, here we go. Here's a little bit different map. So we have Denver up here. You can kind of see these are some of our mountains and Colorado Springs here. And then Pueblo all the way down here. But what we're gonna do here is we're gonna define the bigger watershed. So this is actually the Arkansas River watershed. And the watershed that we're gonna talk about today is actually the Fountain Creek watershed, which is inside of the Arkansas River watershed. And there we go, I was hoping that line would show up. Yes, it did. All right, so the Arkansas River is this thin blue line here. It goes all the way up from Leadville, down to Buena Vista, all the rest of that. It goes south of Colorado Springs. But the watershed that we are all in, and the watershed that we're mainly concerned with, is the one that's right in our own backyard, of course, right? And, of course, there are other smaller watersheds that actually make up the Fountain Creek watershed. We're going to focus on the kind of the bigger area of the Fountain Creek watershed. So this goes all the way up from Woodland Park. It includes Monument, Palmer Lake, and let's see, here we go. We've got Colorado Springs, Manitou Springs, Fountain, and Pueblo all the way down here. So this is basically Fountain Creek. Does everybody kind of get the geographical area of what we're talking about? Okay, so in that watershed, we're collecting water all the way from Pikes Peak at 14,115 feet, or 14 feet, depends on what year you decide that you're gonna hang that up. I think when I first moved here, Pikes Peak was only 14,110 feet, so it grew as we grew. All right. There we go. All right, so in that watershed, we have 927 square miles of land and water, made up of several different cities, counties, political leanings, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But it's all in one, no one cares about the cities, or water doesn't care about the cities, it doesn't care about the counties or the political leanings, et cetera, of the people within it. It only cares about the geographic features. So, let's see what else do we have in this watershed. As I said, 3 counties and 8 cities. And it's a really interesting watershed because it's one of the only watersheds that has such a elevation drop or change in elevation from 14,110 feet all the way down to 4,600 feet down in Pueblo in less than 50 miles. right? So a lot of water in a big area moving pretty fast. It acts like a really, really big funnel. Why is that important? Because there's a lot of water and it moves really fast. And so as we have seen, we have a difficult way of managing that water and actually dissipating it. Let's see, here we go. All right. So what's important? I kind of want to talk to you guys a little bit about, we live in a little bit of a smaller watershed within the Fountain Creek watershed. And so each and every one of us has a very important and a vital role in our watershed about what we do every day. How many of you have dogs? Ooh, good. How many of you have one of these nifty little dog poop bag carriers? Everybody have one of these? Who doesn't have one? Raise your hand. Okay, ready? Can you catch? Good. All right. Did you catch? All right. If you want an extra one, I'll give you an extra one. All right. Awesome. So, why do I talk about dog poop? How many of you have been to, well, Bear Creek Park?
Yeah.
Right back here, right? How many of you have seen other people's dog poop on the trail?
Yeah.
How many of you bothered to stop down and pick that dog poop up? Few less hands. All right. Well, here's the first thing is, if you have a dog, first and foremost, make sure you take one of those little nifty dog poop bag carriers with you. I have one in my car, I have one on my dog, and I have one in my pocket almost at all times, just to make sure, right? And so it's not that hard to pick up my own. It's kind of gross, but that's the responsibility of owning a dog, right? And having one of man's best friends, you also have to clean up after them. So I would encourage you not only to pick up yours and put it in the trash can, don't leave it on the trail. It always is a funny thing to me to see a little blue bag or a little green bag or a little whatever plastic bag sitting on the side of the trail. That's only half the step. You actually have to take it to the trash can and put it in the trash can. Otherwise it sits there and it really doesn't do you any good. It's actually worse because then there's a plastic bag on the trail. All right, so pick up your own and pick up maybe one next to it. Right? It's not that hard to see an extra one. It's a little, I think everybody can do this, right? Can everybody touch their toes? Yeah, that's the activity that we want. It's a good exercise for you. So, why is that important? Because our dog's waste has all sorts of bacteria in it because of their high protein diet, and all of that dog poop sitting on the trail, when it comes down and rains, what happens? I see a few different hands. Anybody want to raise their hand and give me a specific answer? No? All right. Well, I'll answer that for you then. Okay. So dog poop sitting on the top of our watershed, then rain, and it becomes diluted, and all of the bacteria and the E. coli go down into the soil, and eventually everything that all that water that goes down into the soil and goes to our waterways, because as we have learned with the big funnel, that's how that works. Water falls from the top, goes through the soil, and down into our waterways. All right? Any other funny, anybody want to share any other events or stories that they have about their dogs or about walking on the trail and finding interesting things? Do you have a good story? Allison?
I've got it.
All right, good. All right, so moving on. The basic thing of what I'm trying to say is, if you have a dog, you want to pick up the dog poop. What about on the trails? How many of you are Boy Scouts? Anybody a Boy Scout? Or was a Boy Scout? All right, good. So what do you say to Scouts or when you're camping? What's the mantra that we have? Leave it better than you found it, right? Okay, so leave it better than you found it. It's the same thing when you're walking on the trails. Leave it better than you found it. If you see a piece of trash, again, pick it up. You can put it in your pocket until you reach the trash can, but make sure it goes where? Make sure it goes where? In the trash can. Right, because it doesn't do you any good if it's just in your pocket, then you take it and put it next to the trash can, because then it blows all over the place, and then again, all of that trash from the trails, from our streets, it all goes down to the lowest point, which is where? Our waterways. Good, you guys are getting the point. All right, awesome. Okay, good. So we can all do little things every day. Every little thing that we do, everything that happens on our land is eventually going to end up in where?
Waterways.
Good. So you have trash, you have dog poop. How many of you still change your own oil in your car? Anybody? Any oil changers? Okay, good. All right, well, you should check your oil and make sure that, you know, it doesn't leak and all the rest of that. Make sure you keep good maintenance on your car so that any of the fluids don't leak down into or onto the concrete, into the grass, etc., and then end up where? Good. All right. So all these little things, it's a personal responsibility. We're all responsible. We all live in one city. Maybe we don't all live in one city. We live in one area, one watershed, but we're all connected by the water. And every action that we do every day is going to affect the waterway. Right? So we all have a personal responsibility to keep our waterways clean. And it all starts with one person, and that's you. All right, I think I belabored that point quite enough. All right, but the reason that it's our personal responsibility is it's not just our waterways. We can't just get in Fountain Creek because sometimes, you know, we have some dirty water or something like that. You know, we have lots of different things that happen in our waterway, but it's not just what's in our backyard. We have 19 different states that actually depend on the water that comes from our watershed. We're at the very top of the watershed here in Colorado Springs and in Woodland Park and Monument and Palmer Lake. We're at the top of the watershed. So everything that happens at the top of the watershed eventually is going to flow down to all the way down. So you see the Arkansas River that flows all the way down here, and it actually ends up in the Gulf of Mexico. So it's not just about our backyard. That's important to us, right? But it's actually a bigger, more global type of thing that each and every one of us taking personal responsibility can help. So it's a little bit of a different kind of a neat graphic about how all of our waterways affect the world at large. Okay. I heard a wow. That's, yeah, you're right. That's a wow. Right? It's not just, hey, we have, you know, kind of a funny waterway with concrete channels or not concrete channels and, you know, all the rest of that stuff. So it's important that we all take that personal responsibility, because all the trash that we leave and don't pick up can end up in, it causes a great big problem. Everybody's heard of, sorry, all the rubbish patches in the Pacific Ocean. And all of those can actually, we contribute to that when we don't pick up the trash around our own waterway. It just, it all flows down. I'm sure some of you have heard the old adage, plank flows downstream, right? All right, so we have a huge impact and a huge responsibility. But who does it start with?
Us.
Good, all right. It all starts with a single individual, and that's us. Right. I'm going to hand it over to Allison. She's going to talk a little bit more about how we manage all of those different things, all the different resources and things that we use.
Perfect. Thank you. And just to go back really quickly, that image, this is a picture of what's called the dead zone, which occurs in the Gulf of Mexico, usually every year around August or September. Because of all of the upstream pollution, a lot of that being fertilizers, pesticides, chemicals related to farming and other practices, all of that accumulates in one area in the Gulf of Mexico. And when they measured that at the height of its bloom, this algal bloom, it was the size of the state of Connecticut. Wow. This happens every year. So that is a whole area of the ocean, the size of the state of Connecticut, without a little sea star, little Nemo, no dolphins, nothing. So, pretty, I mean, it's an amazing shot, but what that actually is saying is, boy, it's happening all over the U.S., which we're part of that biggest watershed. So watershed management really is working with our partners. We have a huge amount of land that we manage to bring you your water. Does anyone know how far away most of the water that comes to Colorado Springs, how far away is that from us? Because as you saw on that map, we don't have a major river here in Colorado Springs. We've got a lot of really cute little creeks, but they can sustain our community when it comes to water. Any guesses on how far away our water, most of it comes from? 60 miles, more than that.
It's on the western side.
100 times 2. 200 miles away. On the other side of the Continental Divide, 80% of our water comes from over there. So our water flows through 67 distinct watersheds before we bring it to town. We use pipes, we use tunnels. pumps to get it uphill. So it's a huge feat to bring that to you, and by managing the land, we can better manage the water, and that's what our program is about. So we have a lot of risks that are in our watersheds. Sean described the natural setting that we're in is crazy. We're in one of the most erratic watersheds in the whole United States because of this geographic setting. Flooding is nothing new to this area. This has been happening since the beginning of time. We're all drawn to water. Why would you not want to have a little creek in your backyard? Well, because those creeks can get nasty when we get these floods that come through. So this was back from the early 1900s. This was just after the Waldo Canyon fire. And this is something that, are we done with floods now? Are we kind of over with that?
No.
No, absolutely not. We'll continue to see this. This is a pattern that happens in our watershed. Another thing that's been happening, of course, around us is development. We are a growing community. In fact, the state of Colorado is poised to double its population by 2050. So think about your I-25 traffic, think about your ski hills, okay? Think about how are we gonna get water for all of these other people? Big deal. So what's happened with development, when you have an area that's got natural ground cover, trees, meadows, grasses, you get about 50% of that water that hits the land will soak in or infiltrate. As we begin to develop and add these impervious or hard surfaces, this is rooftops, parking lots, driveways, that water cannot soak into those hard surfaces. So what does it do instead? It runs off. It's called runoff. So when we get to an area like this, this is downtown Colorado Springs with 75 to 100% hard surfaces, we've got 15% infiltration and 55% of that is running off now. Is it making sense how this begins to change our environment? This over here, this is on, it's called Monument Branch. It's part of a creek of Monument Creek. And this is a beautiful little stream running into the bigger creek, but behind those trees was a development. Was put in, and this big apartment building, of course, sidewalks, parking lots, and it just has decimated this creek. It's completely choked out the vegetation with all the sediment that's been brought down. It's eroded, it's widened, and it's gonna take a lot to get that back to that natural condition. And this is happening in our creeks everywhere. Not just Colorado Springs, but throughout the world. We're developing our communities, and we're seeing the results in a negative manner. Of course, pollution. Is something that we see on a continual basis. I love these pictures. This is from the state of Washington, their clean water program. They're just showing us that our daily activities, as Sean was mentioning, directly impacts the watershed that's right in our backyard, and that all accumulates downstream. So this right here, this is called a storm drain. You may have seen these along the side of the road. This is not a garbage can. We still have people dumping motor oil deliberately down these drains. There was a neighborhood in Ute Valley, by the Ute Valley Park area, and a couple neighbors started throwing their bagged pet waste down the drain. And because a couple of them saw that, well, everybody else started doing it. And they actually had a flood, and all of those bags backed up onto the street. So you can imagine the odors that were illuminating from that.
Was it their street?
What's that?
Was it their street?
Oh, I doubt it. You know, just neighbors walking around. So, you know, little things add up. So we just like to, you know, let people know that runoff is a big deal. It comes off your roof. It usually is going to go into the street, into these gutters, and then it goes directly out into a creek. If you're from the East Coast or if you're familiar with that environment, they have a separate sewer system where their stormwater goes and gets treated at a plant. That's not the case here in Colorado Springs or the state of Colorado. All of these drains are separate, so they don't go to get clean once they go down here. Now, I would like to invite you all to join me in an activity. We're going to meet the Smith family. They are members of our community that are just going about their daily life, and they're going to do some things, and I'm going to ask those of you that have these cards in your hand to help me just read some of these activities that our Smith family is doing. So these are our friends, these are our neighbors, and we're going to start off with just a nice clean jar of water. All right, so I've got a clean jar of water here, and we'll start, let's see, let's start right here. What does your card read nice and loudly?
All right. Johnny Smith loves keeping his shiny big red truck sparkling clean and washes it in his driveway every chance he gets. Where does that soap go with his hose when he hoses it off his car?
Where does it go when he hoses it off the car?
Right into the water.
Right into the drain, all right. And by the way, is it just soap that's coming off of your vehicle? Brake dust, soot, rust,
all sorts of paint, probably. Okay, very good. And next card.
Salt. It is nice to flavor soup with some salt, which makes me think about how much the Smiths worry about someone falling on their property and suing them. So they apply lots and lots of salt to their driveway, sidewalks, and front porch anytime the snow flies.
All right, so we got to salt those streets so we don't slip and slide. It's very difficult to get salt out of water once it gets in there. Okay, next card.
This will be a good addition. Grass clippings and leaves. Miss Smith loves tending her yard, but she hates raking up clippings and leaves. So she gets out her leaf blower and sends them down the storm drain by her curb. Out of sight, out of mind.
How many of you have, maybe not yourself, maybe a neighbor has those leaf blowers? You don't have to admit if you have one. My neighbor has one, and they like to run it at about 6:15 on a Sunday morning. And so they work great, just, you know, out of sight, out of mind, blow it down the drain. And I've seen landscaping companies, same thing. They'll mow a lawn, and they'll mow all those clippings. That is illegal. The city stormwater program has added about 50 people to their staff. And they are out inspecting and reminding and educating people about things like this, those practices. Okay, next card. Who's got one? Go for it.
Fertilizer and pesticides. Mr. Smith wants to have the greenest lawn on the block. So he bought a brand of fertilizer with lots of phosphorus and added lots of it to his lawn. He forgot to check the forecast because that night it rained and rained. Where did the fertilizer go?
Down the drain, yeah. So paying attention to the weather is really important when you're taking care of your yard. We don't have to use chemicals on our yard. In fact, it's a good idea to think about how can you get rid of some of that bluegrass that is so thirsty in this arid environment. It doesn't make sense to have a grass that's native to Kentucky growing here in Colorado, okay? All right, so a couple more cards out there. Go ahead.
Litter. Teenager Susie Smith loves candy and keeps it in her car so her parents won't yell at her for eating it. So on her way home from school, she'll toss the evidence out her car window.
How many of you have seen a litter bug out there? Intentionally or not, we like to say trash blows. And on these windy days, if you have not bagged and tied your trash, you know, they use those lifters now to put our garbage into the vehicles, and people don't bag their trash, and it just goes flying everywhere. People get killed on highways because of litter coming off of the back of vehicles. It's a safety issue as well. So we don't like to have litter bugs around. A couple more cards.
Vehicle oil and fluids. Mr. Smith is a do-it-yourself guy, and he likes to tinker with his car. He thought he would change his oil, and some of it ended up dripping on his driveway. No big deal until that thunderstorm rolled in.
Ooh, anybody have a leaker out there? What's a good idea if your vehicle is leaking?
Fix it.
Fix it! Hey, great idea! Love it. We are sharp this morning. Okay, if you can't get to your appointment, throw a piece of cardboard under there and allow that to absorb it. If it's already leaked onto your driveway, anybody know a good solution?
Absorb it.
Which, kitty litter. Kitty litter, not used, but kitty litter. Throw that down there, it'll absorb it. All right, very good. And I think we should have two more. Go ahead.
Dog poop. Smiths had a dog who enjoyed taking Bucky for a walk to neighborhood parks, so the dog would do his duty there instead of on their lawn. They often forget to bring plastic back to the bathroom.
Okay, so we're going to add a couple of claps here. Setting the poop. The kids love that one. Okay. And one more card, I believe, out there.
Soil. Okay. Mrs. Smith is adding a new garden plot to her yard. She had to load compost. She had a load of compost delivered to her driveway, but only spread half of it. I mean, the glasses, but half of it on her garden before the rain came in. She quickly ducked inside, leaving her exposed compost pile to wash into the street.
Perfect. All right. How many of you have seen construction projects around town or new garden projects? If you don't have a protection to keep that soil in place, it's going to go right down the drain. And this is one of the worst things for our creeks is that erosion and sediment. When you add that, it makes the water cloudy. Think about the critters that are in our streams that need to be able to see their prey, or they need to have some rocks on the bottom to lay their eggs and be able to sustain that. So our Smith family has gone about their daily activities
Anybody want to take a sip? Okay, there's usually like a fourth grade boy that says, I'll do it. But if you think about it, like we're saying, these little activities add up to a lot, and by changing a little bit of behavior, it can make a huge difference. So thank you for participating in that with me. All right, well, let's talk a little bit about our water law. Everybody ready for a nap? Water laws. All right, so Colorado is very unique in our water rights that we have. We are what's called the prior appropriation system. And this is basically dating back to the 1800s when the miners were coming to Colorado. They would stake their claim and they say, I'm going to get this much water. They are a first-in-time, first-in-right water rights owner. So then if the second person comes along downstream, once this person gets their allotted water, then the junior water rights owner can have his or her allotted amount. And it goes on and on. So people own water in Colorado. First-in-time, first-in-right, and it's use it or lose it. So the senior water right owners gets their right satisfied before anyone else can get theirs. So in the times of drought, that senior water right owner, he's probably is going to get his allotted water. But if we don't have enough for those that are further down in the right system, they're not going to get their water that year. So that's why the rain barrels have been such a big deal. Did you know we were the only state in the nation that did not legally allow them? Okay? And if you want to change any of these water laws, you get to spend a lot of time in water court. Colorado Springs Utilities is heavily involved, all water utilities, in trying to obtain water rights right now to secure that water future for our customers. Water that starts here doesn't stay here. As Sean mentioned, there's 19 states that rely on water that comes from Colorado. We are a headwater state. Okay, we have also this thing called the Colorado Compact, where water that starts in Colorado belongs to those in California, belongs to those in Nevada. They have a mandate to get X amount of water from Colorado. What happens if we go through a long period of drought? They're going through these planning sessions right now trying to figure out how can we sustain our communities as we begin to see more and more drought happening throughout our Colorado basin. This was last year in California, you'll recall, a bit of a drought in that area. Okay. Well, we were looking at doing a state water plan. The governor said, you know, we don't have a water plan. We don't have a plan. This is terrible. So the executive order was placed, and through that process, I wanted to read this quote. We have learned that our current statewide water trajectory is neither desirable nor sustainable. We know that the state must take a hard look at Colorado's water future needs as a whole and plan for how they will be addressed. So our leadership gets it, but we gotta figure out how to get us there. There's been all sorts of information spread about this Colorado State Water Plan. It was the biggest public process to date. 30,000 comments were brought to the governor's office and organized and addressed and tried to figure out how we can get to some of these solutions. So in 2015, this is the first House Bill, 15-1259, for a rain barrel. And it's a mess. It was stuck in the agriculture house, and basically they let the time run out on it and said, oh, we're not going to deal with this right now. Because the water rights owners were very worried that rain barrels would take away from their water right. Okay, so they worried that if we have all of a sudden millions of rain barrels and people taking 55 gallons at a time, would greatly impact their water rights. And those are, you know, long time family owned, and they're very protective of those rights. So, take two. They used the same language, they had the same sponsors, but there was a lot more public support, public outreach, and education. That's what a lot of this is people don't know what they don't know, especially when it comes to water. So, here's a poll from the Denver Post. They said, should the legislature pass a bill that would allow Colorado residents to collect rooftop runoff in rain barrels to be used for gardening? Well, 95% said yes, so that's great. It's huge public support. The letters were coming in, the emails, all of that. So it was finally signed by the governor last year, May 12, 2016. Huge fanfare. Some people got signed rain barrels by the governor. we make national news too. The Huffington Post said, you won't believe what Colorado is about to legalize now. So really fantastic. There's a lot of resources out there. I brought some information just about general watershed stuff, but please feel free to look more into what the rain barrel bill is all about. Here's a pop quiz for you. These rain barrels are legal, true or false? Or are some legal and some not? How about this one? Legal or not?
Not.
Why not?
Too many.
So you're limited to how many?
Two.
Two rain barrels allotted to how many gallons? 110 gallons. So this is illegal. Minnesota, we can have 10 of them strung together. Okay. What about these two? Legal or illegal?
Uncovered.
This is a mosquito's haven. In order to have a rain barrel on your property, you must have some mesh netting or a cover to make sure that it will not allow the breeding of those mosquitoes. How about this guy? That's nice. A little bit. That kind of surpasses that 110 gallons. Sure, be nice. Okay. A lot of benefits for using rain barrels. I'm just going to run through these really quickly. First of all, rainwater is much better for your garden. Okay, chemically treated water that comes out of your tap is not going to support your plants as well as the natural rain that falls. Okay, if we have another drought or watering restrictions, was anyone around for the watering restrictions a couple years ago? Okay, a rain barrel may be able to extend that a little bit and provide you extra water. Reducing stormwater runoff. This is huge. We talked about all the issues when water leaves your property, from pollution to erosion. Okay, the goal here with your property is you want to keep your water on site. You want to slow it from running off. You want to spread it out and allow it to sink in. That's the goal. Okay, you want to prevent erosion either from your property or someone else downstream. Reducing your water usage and saving on our infrastructure. Boy, when we have a pipe burst at Colorado Springs Utilities, one of those pipes can be $1 million just like that. So the less pressure we put on our water infrastructure, the longer those are going to last. Better for your car and pet washing, same as the garden. Great to water your compost bin or pile. You know, same thing, the chemical water is not going to be as good as that natural. You're going to prevent flooding and mold in your basement. You want to keep that water away from your foundation. So if it's coming right off your roof, going into your basement, a lot of people have water issues. You collect it in the barrel, you're preventing that from happening. Of course, saving a few dollars on your water bill. And really, here in Colorado, anyone know how many inches of rain we get on an annual basis? Hundreds, right? Yeah. Feels like seven. About twice that, about 15 inches per year is all we get. So are you going to be able to sustain a huge, lush garden with this little barrel? Probably not. You're probably going to have to do some supplemental watering. But this is a conversation starter. This will help you talk to your neighbors, your family members. Why do you have this barrel? What's with that? Here's all the reasons, and you can probably think of a few more. Oops. So, illegal, now what? Well, there's lots of other things that we can all be doing to help the watershed. Okay, you can participate in our sale, we'll talk about that towards the end here, but there's a lot of other things related to water that we all use. So, the number one way people use water in Colorado Springs is outside on our yards. Okay, again, this dry, arid environment. Why plant a plant that should be in a rainforest when we're here in a desert? Okay, so getting plants that are more adapted to this environment. Okay, showering, bathing, clothes washing, toilets, those are kind of the next in line, and you can always take a shorter shower. You can always fill up your laundry completely. It doesn't make sense to throw in a pair of socks and turn on the washer. Okay, those machines are good if you fill them up and use them the right way. Anyone know of these devices, what is the leakiest one in the house?
Faucet, toilet.
I guess it depends. I haven't seen any of your drips coming out of your toilet, but generally speaking, it is going to be the toilet. So I call this part the throne. And in order to figure out if you have a toilet leak, it's very easy to do. You take the lid off of the back part and you take a peek in here. I have some tabs over there. You put two little tabs in the tank of the toilet. You wait 15 minutes and then you open up the throne. If there's a color in there, if it's blue, or you can even use food color, a couple drops of food color. If the food coloring leaks into the bowl, then you know you have a leaker. You're basically throwing money down your drain because you're getting charged for water that you're not using. Sometimes you can hear that leaky toilet, a lot of times it's silent. Okay, so take a look at that. See if you can save some of your bucks on your water bill. A lot of other opportunities for water conservation. We're going to be paying more for water in our future. That's a fact. Because it is so difficult to get it here, because our infrastructure is aging, let's figure out, you know, taking shorter showers. Don't water the sidewalk. How many of you have seen, you know, the water, it's beautiful, fans around, and it's water the sidewalk of the street. Drives me crazy. Again, throwing that money out the window. We talked about getting rid of some of your bluegrass, fixing leaks, testing your toilet, running your machines when they're full. Lots of opportunities here, inside and outside the home. Do you want to talk about Creek Week?
No, I'm gonna let you talk about
Creek
Week.
You're good? Okay, all right. Another opportunity here within our watershed, and there's a lot of partners that we've included with this, is Creek Week. This is a 9-day watershed-wide cleanup program. We provide the bags, the gloves, we did cool bandanas last year, we did water bottles the year before, but it is a way that we can all together as a watershed do our part, play our role in protecting the environment. So it's always the last Saturday in September through the first Sunday in October. The reason why it's 9 days is because there's no excuses. Oh, your kid has soccer practice on Saturday? Do it on Sunday. The weather's crappy on Monday? Do it on Tuesday. So we're taking away that barrier for you. We get a lot of support from the community, from local businesses. This is good for everyone. Who likes to go for a bike ride and see garbage all over the place? You know, so I would just really encourage you to participate in this. We've also increased the number of adopters that are in our community. So if you're part of maybe a church organization or leading a scout group, your group can say, this part of the creek is really special to me and I want to sign up to clean it 2 times a year. That's all the commitment is to be a adopter, a spring and a fall. Mm-hmm. And that way we're providing ownership, having people recognize that, yeah, there are creeks in our backyards and we care about them. So it's been a really successful program. Last year was our third year. We had 2,400 people in all 8 watershed communities remove 14 tons of litter.
Wow.
So it was amazing. Yeah. So we're going to grow. We're going to continue to grow that. I'd love to see all of you there. There's multiple sites. Just stay tuned for that one.
Why don't you tell them about the clean and crawl, too?
Oh, the clean and crawl. That was a favorite one. So we partnered with some bar establishments on Tejon Street, and we started at Oscar's. We gave everyone bags and gloves and sweepers, and we were out there with the new city stormwater division manager and a couple of his staff, and we did a pub crawl slash cleanup all the way down Tejon Street. We went over to people that were having their brunch at Coquette's. Oh, do you like clean water? You enjoying your glass of water there? How about you want to donate to Creek Week? And so we got donations coming in. We cleaned out the storm drains. We marked the storm drains with those little fishies that remind people, you know, not to throw stuff down there. So it was a really fun event. We're going to be doing that both weekends of Creek Week this year. So if you're over 21, please think about doing the creek claw, the clean and crawl. Hard to say. We also do a program called Scoop the Poop. We've talked about that. We kind of beat this one to death because it's so prominent. We're such a dog-friendly community here. But E. coli is one of the big bad bacteria that's found in most streams here in our watershed. And we exceed the state standards from May to October. Okay, so this is a major, major deal. I really like this one. This is the fecal coliform bacteria machine. This guy says, I poop, you pick it up. Any questions? So unless your dog can do this, you're off the hook.
Let's get fall through.
Right. Well, right here, bag. Keep it, bag it. Right. Exactly. I worked with Colorado College students last year to continue to define this issue for our community. This is a 3/4 mile loop in Palmer Park. Anyone been to Palmer Park before? Oh, great spot. By the way, this was one of those trailheads that had a garbage can and scoop the poop bags.
Yes.
This is 95 pounds of pet waste on a 3/4 mile trail in one of our amazing parks. They GPS, all those little dots are little GPS, and they scooped it at the same time. They didn't just like, you know, mark it and walk away.
So
they
said, that's
just dog. Yep, exactly. Then they mapped land that's within 500 meters of a park and within 100 meters of a waterway. Where are our parks? Right next to our waterways. So I just thought that is such eye-opening information, and I'm going to try to work with some team volunteers to station them at trailheads this summer and provide some of this information, because I think people don't know that it is bad for the environment. Question?
Well, not really a question, but we went hiking a lot this last year, and at a lot of these parks, especially like state parks and whatnot, there are those stations, but they're missing the bags.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I mean, it doesn't do any good to have that station and it's empty. So is it a funding issue? Is it they don't have enough maintenance staff to refill those? That's a problem here in Colorado Springs. As you know, our parks departments, both city and county, are completely underfunded. This is the reason why most of us live here, is this beautiful environment, and we don't have the staff that can help take care of it. That's why we're, you know, trying to engage the community. You know, let's get some volunteers. Let's show our community that we deserve better than what's happening out there. So I would recommend take 10 of those little scoop the poop things. If you guys go to the parks, hand them to people. They don't do any good sitting in Allison's office. So please give these out to people. It's a great tool to use, and it makes a huge difference.
What about the more open space type areas where, you know, people let their dogs go off leash? And then I think it's not a problem because it's out so far away.
Well, I didn't see it. I didn't let it dog. What are you?
Well, all the other animals use that. So why, is that?
I don't know what the solution is there. I did do a training with some volunteers with City Parks. They have a program called Bark Rangers. So these are volunteers, they get a hat, their dog gets a bandana, they walk around with coupons from Wagon Wash and hand that out as a thank you to people that are doing the right things in the parks.
That's pretty cool.
So the Bark Rangers program, that's a city, I'm not sure if the county has anything similar, but you know, we do our Scoop the Poop days at the Bear Creek Dog Park. April Stools Day, by the way, that's another one of our accounted for. You gotta have fun with it, right? So April Stools Day is the first Saturday in April, we'll be at the Bear Creek Dog Park. You know, edutaining about dog poop. So,
Rangers also go with dogs because dogs are not supposed to be off leash in these parks.
Right.
They're supposed to be on them.
Oh, and that's the thing, is we don't have the enforcement. Yeah. There's nobody that's enforcing the rules. It's a big challenge. So,
why not pass an ordinance that it's illegal to enter a park without a collection bag?
Yeah. I love that idea. You know, that's a great idea. How do you get that into law? How do you make that ordinance? We gotta
start writing
letters. We've got new city council members coming in. Who of our new city council cares about our parks? You know, that's just something that we can all think about. Who's supporting our initiatives?
But the problem is, like you said earlier, it's enforcing.
Yep.
Because Bear Creek Park, the only place that you can have a dog off the leash is the dog park. Talk to the neighbors around here. And there's 101 excuses why the dog shouldn't be on leash.
Right.
Yep. You know, so that's the hard part.
Absolutely.
I have a whole slew, and I save it and take it sometimes to the Humane Society, but from our newspapers. It would be nice if there were like some city collection sites. And I say that because Bear Creek's good at having people bring their own bags and fill those, but I don't know where else they're needed. And I could give you about 300 right now.
I would say bring them to the City Parks and Recreation Office and have their rangers distribute them. Yeah. I'm sure they would be happy to do that.
But if the city knew that, because for all of us who get the newspaper, we can supply them free to the city.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Yeah, it's a great way to recycle those too. Little off topic, sorry, poop gets people going. So now we're on to questions. I think Sean's going to, you want to talk about this?
Sure.
That's great.
Okay. All right, so this is a trash can, right?
No.
Oh, okay, good. I have people get confused about this all the time, especially when I drive around like 30 of them in the back of my truck. Everyone wonders, where's he going with 30 trash cans? Well, this is a little bit different than a trash can. Yes, people ask me all the time, well, why would I buy a rain barrel? It's just a trash can with a hole in the bottom. You're right, it sort of is just a trash can with a hole in the bottom. However, I don't have to put the hole in this one, and this one keeps out mosquitoes. It's made out of 100% recycled plastic. It's made in America. It's all sorts of other good things besides just a plastic trash can. So, first and foremost, it is just a 50-gallon trash can as a base, right here. And then, there's a little bit different because this one actually has a nice little threaded hole right here to actually take the other piece, which is the spout. Right, so I'll put that up there. That's the main part because that's where all your water goes. You have two of those. All right, and then I'll show you the other pieces that all of these come with. So we talked about these particular ones. They are recycled plastic. They're black because the heat from the sun is actually going to heat up your water and helps keep the mosquitoes out or any larvae or anything else like that if they happen to get in there. However, this one is equipped with a nice cool lid, which is a really nice feature. All right, so this is a really hefty duty lid. It's not like a trash can lid, and it's indented. You could turn over a trash can lid and kind of create the same sort of funnel effect. However, your trash can doesn't feel nice and heavy. It's not an inch and a half thick. It's not double wall, and it doesn't have this nice little cutout with a piece of mesh in it, right? So this little piece of mesh is really important for why? We talked about it earlier. Mosquitoes, right? Okay, well, it's good for mosquitoes, that's true. Keeps the mosquito larvae out. What else happens on your roof? What else gets onto your roof?
Leaves, limbs.
Somebody raised their hand and told me that.
Shoes,
though. Dog poop, I mean. Dog poop on the roof, but someone who has bad neighbors. You talk to neighbors if you have dog poop on your roof. But you have pollen, you get leaves, you get twigs, all the rest of that stuff. And when it rains, it all comes off, and it's either in your gutters, or if it happens to go through your gutters, like the pollen and the dirt and all the rest of that stuff, and you have one of these hooked up to your gutters, it's going to go, all of that dirt and everything else like that, it's going to go straight into your rain barrel, right? Now, this little screen is going to stop everything from going into your rain barrel, but like the asphalt shingle, the little pebbles and things like that, it will stop that. And what's really great about this is, as you can see, I've really easily taken this apart. So if you need to clean that screen, or if, say, a twig gets stuck in there and then it jams a hole through there and everything, your screen kind of becomes ineffective. But it's really simple to go to a place like Home Depot or Lowe's or Ace Hardware or wherever, and it comes with this nice little form that you can actually even cut the circle with. You just put that on top of a square piece and you cut a circle and you've got a brand new piece of screen. Really easy maintenance is basically what I'm trying to say. All right? So, and then you just pop that back there. Oh, there we go. All right. So that's your lid. Like I said, it's really nice and hefty and it just goes right on here. It's even shaped the right size so that it fits nice and snug. And it actually adds form to this, what could be pretty flimsy. Let's see if I can maybe, I may have to take this down. Yep, all right. I gotta see on top of it as I got it, right? Okay, so what's cool about this, not only is it recycled and they designed it very well, but instead of a lot of other rain barrels that are shaped like big keg barrels, right, those don't stack inside of each other. These do. So even in just trying to be environmentally aware and help, so you can fit 32 of these on a pallet, whereas if you had the other kind of rain barrel, the, you know, kind of keg style rain barrel, those don't fit inside of each other, you can fit 8 on a pallet. Right? So quite a few more, saves gas and the shipping, saves time, saves plastic to wrap them all up. There's a lot of other processes that we can eliminate just by designing well. Right, so this is just a well-designed piece, and it's a seamless kind of piece too. Anyway, it's a nice little rain barrel, and I'm gonna show you the other little pieces. I'll put this back up here so that we can catch it on camera as well, because there are two other pieces. Now that I've got the lid on there, one, this is the most important piece. This is your valve on the bottom. It's just a 3/4 inch PVC valve. You can get them at Home Depot or whatever. So if it breaks, if it freezes, if anything else like that happened, again, it's an easily replaceable part. Now there's a little rubber ring already stuck in that hole because I've already put this one together a few different times and taken it apart. Now, the one thing you want to make sure you do when you put this ring barrel together is this little thing you want it to point out. Otherwise, you can't access it once it's on there, right? So this is basically just your on and off valve. When it's out like that, it's on, close like that, right? The ring gets that. Right, so you just want to take a few minutes and make sure you're lined up. Pop it in there. And voila, right? Now you have a fully functional rain barrel, right? It's going to collect water. Put your hose up to it, and it'll empty out the water. Okay? Pretty simple. Other couple of features. Majors is, how many of you have ever seen, how many like zip ties, right? Zip ties are great how many times?
Once.
Right, once, not these, because these are really cool. These are actually reusable zip ties. So I just put that together and then I click that little thing and it'll come out again and you can reuse it. Why is that important? Because to keep other critters, and I always call it a child protector, just in case you have a young kid who wants to look inside of a ring barrel, and you know this is going to keep them out of it. As well, it'll keep, you know, if raccoons try to get in your ring barrel and drink the water or whatever, and this keeps the lid on, right? So there's two of these, and there's nice little flange here, and a nice little flange here that you just put that through. Pretty simple, right? Of course, I say it's simple, and then it takes me forever to do it in front of that crowd, right? All right, so we get those on there. Then we have one other, or two other pieces. We have a hose, and we have a little plastic cap. Why do you think this plastic cap and this hose are important? What do you think they're for? What's that?
Overflow.
So, overflow for this one, but what's this for? Why is this important?
Keep things from going up it.
What's that?
To keep things from going up the tube.
Okay, could keep things from going up the tube. However, how many little spouts do you see on the side of this?
Two.
Right? If this one's open, what can get in there?
Mosquitoes.
Mosquitoes, exactly. So, you stick that on there, that keeps the mosquitoes out of the side that is not your actual overflow. Right? So that keeps out of top, out of that extra little side. Why are there two? Because one is an overflow, and the other side could be used. If you take two of these little hoses, you cut one short, you fill up one, and they're sitting next to each other, it'll drain into the next one by this hose, right? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So in other words, I'm going to put this one, and this is basically, it's called an overflow hose. And it has a nice little bracket here that you can screw and make it tight. You want to make sure it's nice and tight because it will come off. I'm not going to do it here because whoever takes this one home, they can do that when they get home. All right? But, so basically this is your ring barrel setup. If you had two, this would go, one would go in your right underneath your gutter spout, and you can either cut your gutters off and put this right underneath there, or there's these nice little diverter valves that you can stick on your gutter. It's in the middle, and then you put the rest of your gutter back together. So when you want it to drain into the ring barrel, you turn a little switch and it comes out the diverter into here. And say in the winter time, when you have ice that melts and stuff like that, your rain barrel is upside down so that you don't have a big frozen block of ice. Mm-hmm. Right? Everybody caught that part? In the winter time, you don't want your rain barrels collecting rainwater, snow water, all the rest of that, because water turns into what when it gets cold?
Ice.
When this gets cold and it's got water in it, what happens when water turns to ice?
It expands,
right? And then this thing gets deformed. It starts to leak, and then your ring barrel is no good. But if you want to buy another one, the Greenway Fund has a sale. So you can fill it with ice if you want to. All right, so pretty simple. If you have two of these, like I said, this one would go underneath your gutter. You would cut this little tube short, and then when this one fills up from the gutter, it'll fill into the next one. Right? Everybody got that?
Yeah.
Any questions about how the ring barrel works? How many can you have?
Two.
What if you have two in your front yard and two in your backyard? No. You can only have one in your front yard and one in your backyard. That's what I have in my house. Because that way it's easier to water my garden in the front and easier to water in the back. Alright. So, no questions about rain barrels? Alright, good. We're going to do a drawing here in a second as soon as I talk about when our sale is. Alright, so the Greenway Fund on August 10th. Go ahead. Sure. The diverter valve?
Yeah.
Well, there's two places you can get it. Well, there's actually several. Everyone knows this really great place that exists in the world, and for some reason we're all connected to it all the time now on our phones and on at home and things like that, right? The internet. So you can search for a gutter rain barrel diverter valve or a gutter diverter valve, and your gutters are going to be a couple of different sizes. Most of them are a 2x3 size. Some of them are a 3x4 size. You have to actually go outside and measure your downspout and make sure you get the right size. The other thing is when we do our rain barrel sale. So this year, our rain barrel sale, it's called a truckload sale because basically we get to bring you a rain barrel for $75, which is about half price of most of the other rain barrels on the market. And part of that, about, I think $10, actually $12 of that goes back to the Greenway Fund, and that helps support projects like the Legacy Loop, like Creekside, and some of the other different watershed-wide projects that we're working on. But from April 1st, April 1st through May 15th, I thought I had it backwards. April 1st, there will be a website that will go live. I don't have the address for it yet because it hasn't been created yet. But on April 1st, I will send you out an email, and if you haven't signed up for our email list, you can sign up on a sheet right over there. So if you want to be notified when the rain barrel sale goes live, sign up for our email over there. But on April 1st, that website will go live, and it'll be live from April 1st through May 15th. You can order two rain barrels, and you can also order two rain barrel gutter diverters as well. So there will be a rain barrel and gutter diverters that will be for sale. And all of those will come in a truck and be delivered on June 3rd. So that's when you will come to our selected location. Last year we did it on the new Legacy Loop Trailhead. We're likely going to do it there again, but it actually may be under construction, so we have to confirm that with Parks and Rec at the moment. But the pickup location is to be determined. But on June 3rd, you come, and from 9 o'clock to 11 o'clock, you come and you pick up your rain barrel. It's a cool process to watch 400 rain barrels disappear in 2 hours.
That's cool.
Right? We got some great pictures and some great video from last year's sale. Last year we sold 404 rain barrels. The average rain barrel is going to probably collect about 250 gallons. So if you do the math, that's what? 8,000. Is that the math right? 8,000? You're not the right person to ask. Actually, it's 80,000. If I think about it, if I add all the zeros correctly, 400 times 200 is about 80,000 gallons of water that is slowed down. It all ends up in the waterway because all it does is it slows it down, it spreads it out, it lets it dissipate. It doesn't pick up the toxins that are on the street or on the impervious surfaces. It's not running as fast, so it doesn't pick up the fertilizers in your lawn and things like that. So all of those things that were in this beautiful bottle right here, it helps keep those from our waterways. It doesn't necessarily, because remember, water is cyclical. When you use it and everything else like that, it still ends up back in the water cycle, right? So it just slows it down. And it changes some of the timing of when we can use our water. So that's why it was such a big deal as far as the water rights laws. Again, first in time, first in right. So the first in time, those people weren't necessarily getting the water at the same time. But what we can do is, again, we're creating healthier waterways from a rain barrel. And we're creating a conversation about the sustainable methods, about keeping our waterways clean, lots of other things. So. Anybody have any questions about the rain barrels, about the rain barrel sale?
Did you say that they're $75?
They are $75, yeah. So, all right, any other questions? A couple of other things that are coming up. You can tell water is really important to us, and we like to drink it in lots of different ways. One of our favorite ways, of course, is with beer. So Bristol does their common hours every other Tuesday or something like that. But March 28th from 6 to 8 p.m. in the Bristol Tap Room, we'll actually be hosting the Karma Hour, which will benefit the Greenway Fund. So $1 from every pint you order that evening from 6 to 8 p.m. is gonna go to help support the Greenway. Again, like salute projects, Creekside projects, even Monument Creek projects that we're actually working with, the Monument Creek IGA, our intergovernmental agreement. Which is something that's what IGA stands for. Of course, I'm going to go over here to this one because it's actually next in line. April 22nd is our Great American Cleanup as well. We are one of the waterway adopters. So we did one of our first cleanups when we did our rain barrel sale last year. On that day, we made 400 rain barrels disappear, and then we made about a ton and a half to 2 tons of trash disappear as well. So that was a really cool, really great day. And then, of course, May 11th is our annual Greenway Fund Forum with some great speakers lined up, and that'll be at the Penrose House from 4 to 7 p.m. And you'll get the email there it'll come out, get you to RSVP and all the rest of that if you sign up for it. All
right. Great. All right. We're ending a few minutes early. We're happy to talk to you about anything that we covered today. Thanks so much for coming. Have a good rest of your day.